Good morning. Good morning out there in TV land, and good morning out there on the pavilion. It's great to have you with us this morning on this sort of gray day in Naples, an unusual morning. We're so happy to have you here. I'm especially happy to see people who were here yesterday and came back today. We had a memorial service yesterday, so twice in one weekend. That's great duty. Thank you very much. Thanks for Daniel Goodsit to be sitting in the chair back in the AV room, and John Forsythe for helping set things up this morning. Thank you to Abby and Sean Allison for being here and having some great music in store for us. Thank you to Matson Maddie Bavaro, who's going to light our chalice this morning. I'm looking forward to that. So welcome. My name is Tony Fisher, and I serve this congregation as its minister. I have done so now for almost 7, 8 years, something like that. When I arrived, the congregation had just developed its own mission statement under the auspices of a great leadership team, including Walt Foley, who was the president at the time, and consultant from the UUA. Our statement says that we are a welcoming congregation, freely seeking intellectual and spiritual growth, that we strive to create a larger community of peace, justice, and love. And it is our job to sort of try and live in to that mission statement, and I see that happening every single day here at UUCGN. If you out there have found us online for the first time, welcome. I hope that you'll make yourself known in the comment section below the video box on Facebook. Welcome to you. Also, if you're new to us, either in the sanctuary or out there, if you could send an email to office@uunaples.org. It's really simple, office@uunaples.org. Our office administrator, Anna Riazzi, will get in touch with you, send you all you need to know about the congregation, and get you on our mailing list so that you can sort of hear all the things that are going on a regular basis, and there are plenty. Now, if you would, take a deep breath, and let's center ourselves into our time together with this morning's prelude.
Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child, a long ways from home, a long ways from gone. Sometimes I feel like I'm almost gone, a long ways, a long ways, a long ways from home.
Here, in the refuge of this Sabbath home, we turn our busy minds toward silence and our hearts toward one another. Though we each walk with a vast loneliness, the promise we offer here is that we do not walk alone. This is a holy place in which we gather, the light of the earth brought in and held, touched by our own answering light. The flame on a chalice, the flicker of a candle, the lamp of our open faces brought near. In this place of silence and celebration, solemnity and music, we make sanctuary and name our home. Let's join together in the chalice lighting. Words will be on the screen as Maddie comes forward. In the light of truth, the warmth of community, and the fire of commitment, we gather this day. May the flame we now kindle be to us a symbol of the unity we seek. Thank you, Maddie. Let's join together in singing our opening hymn. We'll sing in our masks. We'll sing in our masks. You can rise if you feel comfortable doing that. Number 360 in the gray hymnal. The words will be on the screen. Here we have gathered.
Gathered side by side, circle of kinship, come and step inside. May all who seek here find a kindly word. May all who speak here come with they've been heard. Now together, this our heart's own song. Here, nearly gathered, called to celebrate days of our lifetime, matter small and great. Me of all ages. Women, children, men, infants and sages, sharing what we can. Sing now together this our heart's own song. Life has its battles, sorrows and regret, but in the shadows let us not forget. We who now gather know know each other's pain. Kindness can heal us, as we gain. Sing now in friendship this our heart's own song.
We who now gather know each other's pain. Kindness can heal us, certainly. But how much do we actually share each other's pain? We have just gone through a remarkable time, still coming out of it. Each of us have experienced some disconnect during this time, some sense of isolation, loneliness perhaps, anxiety certainly, for all the things that have been going on. We often don't like to admit we're struggling, except maybe to those really close to us. Don't like to admit that we're not sort of fully together, whole. We don't want to elicit any sympathy from anybody. That would be almost the worst thing. But we hesitate to ask when we are in need of each other. In one of my early seminary classes, it was a course, in fact, online course, one of the first offered at Andover Newton, was a course on ministering to seniors. And we were having a chat room discussion, meaning, you know, you could be on or off or at any time over the course of a week entering into that conversation. Today, and the course that I'm taking now, we're on Zoom all the time. We do our breakout sessions on Zoom. We're face-to-face. It's a very different experience than trying to engage in conversation over time and through text. But so this was a conversation about loneliness, and somewhere on the third day of that week that this was the topic of conversation, it had been particularly rich, actually. One of our classmates who was living away from campus, taking the online course, came out as experiencing a real sense of isolation and loneliness. As I said, she was living away from school and not engaged in campus life at all. In her post, she shared something she'd found online. A little poem by somebody named Kath Glasgow. And it went like this. How could I be so lost in a place I know so well? How could I be so broken in a family so together? How could I be so lonely surrounded by so many? How could I be so unhappy surrounded by so much beauty? How could I be me when even I remain a mystery to myself? This sharing allowed the conversation, again, unfortunately, over time, to actually go a little deeper. And while we weren't able to sit with this person and attempt to minister to them directly, face to face, we were able to at least show some sense of presence for this person. And she responded with gratitude, feeling like through her reaching out, she had made an important connection and sort of dissipated at least a little bit that sense of isolation. And I tell the story not so much because we were able to at least communicate that to our classmate and honoring her isolation, her feelings, and being present. But I offer it because each of us, especially during this time, have been touched by loneliness. Whether we experience it personally or deeply, superficially, or whether somebody within our circle has felt the pang of loneliness and struggles with that. And I hope, since I hope your circle of connections includes many of those or all of those in this room, then you have in fact been touched by loneliness, because there is loneliness in this room. And this is our conversation today, aided by some wonderful music. Let's center ourselves into a time of sharing with centering hymn number 396 in the Gray Hymnal, "I Know This Rose Will Open" by Mary Gregoria. We'll sing it through twice.
I know this rose will open. I know my fear will burn away. I know my soul will unfurl its wings. I know this rose will open. I know this rose will open. I know my fear will burn away. I know this soul will unfurl its wings. I know this rose will open.
Standing here thinking about our lives over the past 18 months and how each of us, I'm sure, felt isolated in our own way, despite whether or not we had people living in our home with us or not. I think also of people who felt isolated in their roles in this society, feeling unable to express themselves, unable to share what they needed to share in order to have that conversation that's so important in our lives, that sense of connection and communication. So we hold in our hearts this morning all of you and all of our society for what we've been through. If you have someone in particular that you're holding in your heart this morning, whether in joy or sorrow, I hope that you will, in a moment, speak that name out into this space and share it with us and the world. And you online, if you would do the same, and those on the pavilion, I hope too, will join in this. As I've said before, often in voicing a name, in vibrating our lungs and our larynx, we create some energy that hopefully can go out into the world. So if you have someone you'd like to share a name, then I will allowed to do from left to right. Let's do this. Thank you. Thank you for those thoughts. And knowing that there are many names who remain unspoken and many joys and sorrows that remain in our hearts, we light this candle of community. And let's join now in the spirit of meditation, followed by some shared silence. Spirit of love, as we sit in the quiet of this sanctuary, we can feel connection or isolation. We can feel relaxed and still, or we can feel uncomfortable and restless. Some will be in the moment, focusing on the breath. Some will be planning their day. Some will be thinking about loved ones needing care. Some will be thinking of their own joys or sorrows. Each of these feelings is here and present this morning, each real and honest and true. That we are together in this sanctuary this morning is the important thing. And in our sanctuary created online. Let's honor the diversity of our lives, even in this quiet moment. All the comings and goings, the inner workings and the outer connections. And let us be present with and for each other today, now. Let's share some silence together. This morning's reading is from Anne Morrow Lindbergh, who wrote a beautiful book in 1955 titled Gift of the Sea. If you've not read it, even 70 years later, it still rings quite true. We are all in the last analysis alone. And this basic state of solitude is not something we have any choice about. It is, as the poet Rilke says, not something one can take or leave. We are solitary. We may delude ourselves and act as though this were not so. That's all. But how much better it is to realize that we are so, yes, even to begin by assuming it, naturally. Rilke goes on to say, if we assume it, we will turn giddy. Naturally. How one hates to think of oneself as alone. How one avoids it. It seems to imply rejection or unpopularity. An early wallflower panic still clings to the world. One will be left, one fears, sitting in a straight-backed chair alone while the popular girls or boys are already chosen and spinning around the dance floor with their hot-palmed partners. We seem so frightened today of being alone that we never let it happen. Even if family, friends, and movies should fail, there's still the radio or the television to fill the void. Now, instead of planting our solitude with our own dream blossoms, we choke the space with continuous music, chatter and companionship to which we do not even listen. It is simply there to fill the vacuum. When the noise stops, there is no inner music to take its place. We must relearn to be alone.
Solitude stands by the window. She turns her head as I walk in the room. I can see by her eyes she is waiting. Standing in the slant of the late afternoon, and she turns to me with her hand extended. Her palm is split with a flower and a flame. Solitude stands in the doorway. I'm struck once again by her black silhouette, by her long, cool stand and her silence. I suddenly remember each time we've met, and she turns to me with her hand extended. Her palm is split with a flower and a flame. Says I've come to set a twisted thing straight. And she says I've come to lighten this dark heart. And she takes my wrist, I feel her imprint of fear. And I said I never thought of finding you.
So I have to admit to, as I think all of you, a real strong sense of disquiet over the past 18 plus months. Not to mention loneliness. I mean, certainly standing here on a Sunday morning and looking at empty chairs is not the most fun thing in the world to do. And so it is absolutely wonderful to have people here, you here especially, but even in sort of my greater existence, that sense of disconnect was very strong at times. You know, there were times when I engaged and times when I, for whatever reason, held back. And like you, I imagine, I can't obviously know, I can't ask you to raise your hand and say yes or no, but I suspect that so many of you felt similarly. Today we're talking about loneliness, and that's not one monolithic thing. It occurs to us in very brief moments when we feel like maybe we've been pushed aside or set aside or not listened to, but it can go deeper. In their book titled Loneliness, Human Nature and the Need for Social Connection, John Cacioppo and William Patrick tell us that loneliness is a fact of life. And their work seeks to explain in a psychological way how loneliness happens, how it works, why it's natural. Almost everyone feels the pangs of loneliness at certain moments, they write. It can be brief or superficial, being the last one chosen for the team, or it can be acute and severe, suffering, significant change in life, the death of a spouse or of a close friend or of a pet. Transient loneliness is so common, the authors say, that we do simply accept it as a part of life. We are, after all, social beings. When we're asked what pleasures we think contribute the most to happiness, the overwhelming majority of us rate love and intimacy and social affiliation above wealth and fame or even physical health. But a sense of separation from this kind of healthy intimacy can also be a long-lasting experience. Most therapists will tell you that a large percentage of people that they see come out of loneliness. They may not identify their problem in that way. They may say they're having trouble with relationships, or they're depressed, or they're bored, but the underlying issue sometimes, or most often, is the sense of social disconnection. The pandemic, COVID, has only exacerbated what is a pre-existing condition in our society. Why is it so prevalent? Beyond the brief and superficial experiences that make us momentarily feel alone, why do we humans suffer so much from loneliness? Why, given our situation, even before COVID, roughly 20% of individuals, that would be 60 million people in the United States, feel sufficiently isolated for it to be a major source of unhappiness in their lives? Cacioppo and Patrick believe there are three primary factors, looking at the psychology. The first is our level of vulnerability to social disconnection, and there are evolutionary, genetic, and experiential reasons for this. From an evolutionary standpoint, neuroscientists agree that for tens of thousands of years, it was the need to send and receive, interpret, and relay complex social cues that drove the expansion of the human brain. In other words, it was the need to deal with other people that, in large part, made us who we are today. As individuals, we inherit a certain basic body type, a basic level of intelligence, and so, too, do we inherit a certain level of need for social inclusion. Some of us are introverts, some of us are extroverts. According to the authors, the individual genetically rooted propensity operates like a thermostat, turning off and on distress signals depending on whether or not our individual need for connection is being met. My inherent need would be different from yours, but over the course of the pandemic, most of our internal regulatory devices were screaming. The second factor that the authors talk about is our ability or our inability to self-regulate the emotions that we have associated with the feeling of isolation. Based on our own makeup and, again, our experiences, how much coping ability do we actually have when something happens, let's say a pandemic, that increases our sense of isolation? It can hamper us in our ability to regulate at the emotional level, even at the cellular level, they say, leaving us more and more vulnerable to outside stressors and less able to carry out health-preserving functions like getting a good night's sleep or reaching out. The third factor at play in the depth of an individual sense of loneliness is our mental representations and expectations of others. As the reading from Anne Morrow Lindbergh suggests, there's no denying that we're all individual entities, physically and mentally separate. Each of us frames our experiences through our own perceptions, and the sense that we can make of our interactions with others is called social cognition. Cacioppo and Patrick suggest that when loneliness sets in, the way we see ourselves and others are influenced significantly by those stresses that we're under. Our feelings of unhappiness and our sense of isolation, all of which can lead to an impaired ability to self-regulate. Thomas More, the psychotherapist and the former monk and writer, tells of a woman he knew who held a significant role in a large corporation. Outwardly, she seemed fully engaged in life. She was a great conversationalist, expressing an interest in so many things. She's always going places, keeping herself busy practically 24 hours a day. But at night, when she was alone and could no longer distract herself, the demon of her loneliness appeared, and she couldn't sleep. At various times, she actually thought of suicide. The woman would often speak of how wonderful people were and how much she enjoyed being surrounded by friends, but more also knowing that this woman had difficulty with closeness, with intimacy, suspected that the enjoyment that she had in those moments with other people was really only a disconnected wishful thinking, and that her loneliness had nothing to do with the number of people that she had around her, and everything had to do with a certain sense of moralistic self-protection that she, her own boundaries set up, that she had exhibited most of her life. Her expectations of friendship and community were so high that she wouldn't allow herself to truly enter into either for fear that she'd be let down. This is maybe an extreme case, but how many of us actually have ways in which we set up our own barriers to reconnecting, to not reaching out? On any scale, loneliness saps our vitality. It makes us feel scared and insecure and vulnerable. It's an assault on our senses and our own sense of worth and our dignity. Thus, our unregulated responses to the very feeling of loneliness, we become our own worst enemy, pushing away or worse, lashing out at those with whom we want to be closer. The point is, whatever caused a sense of disconnection in the first place, whether it was a small occurrence or a significant event, whether it was something that occurred to us in our distant past or in our recent memory, whatever it was, that something was inflicted upon us by someone else or of our own making, our own fears, these three factors that the authors talk about, our sort of inherent sense of vulnerability, our inability to self-regulate, these things continue to play out. Lindbergh, in her beautiful little book, Gift from the Sea, states all this succinctly and poetically. It's not physical solitude that actually separates one from another, not physical isolation, but spiritual isolation. It's not the desert island or the stony wilderness that cuts you from people you love. It's the wilderness of the mind, the desert wastes and the heart through which one wanders lost and a stranger. When one is a stranger to oneself, then one is estranged from others too. Only when one is connected to one's own core is one connected to others. But how do we do that? No one wants to feel the pain of loneliness, but how do we reconnect to ourselves, let alone others, if we're feeling lost? Like the poem my classmate shared, how could I be so lonely, surrounded by so many? How could I be me when even I remain a mystery? Well, unfortunately, there's no one way through. Writers like Lindbergh and Moore would say that this is inner work, that the key to reconnection first requires getting comfortable with our own true self, and both writers suggest in slightly different ways that the core, the inner spring, can best be refound through solitude and deep reflection. Wait, I say. You mean that in order to get through loneliness, I have to spend more time in solitude? One of my colleagues once wrote a wonderful comparison between loneliness and solitude. It's a sailing metaphor. Solitude is when you're out on the water and you're your sails are full of wind. Loneliness is when you're out there and the wind dies. Pointing out that a person living in a city teeming with people can be lonely and in need of something other than people, Moore suggests the cure for loneliness isn't necessarily to force yourself to be around other people, but to get to the root of the issue. this inner call for reflection to think about how we might be creating our own barriers in addition to those barriers that are thrown up in front of us. It may be that a little more intentional solitude, sails full of wind, and deeper reflection can carry us through loneliness and out to something on the other side, as opposed to staying stuck where we are. Loneliness is natural, but being stuck and deepening into it is not. This would be the Buddhist way of understanding as well, that peace comes from making changes inside, finding inner peace through meditation and mindfulness, being able to recognize your ego voice and letting it go. Thomas More suggests this combination of soul work and active engagement in the world, and simply start leaning in and living with the loneliness, not by joining organizations and trying to get out of it, but by living through the feelings of relatedness to other people and to other things, to nature and to society and to the world as a whole, to art. The best way to deal with loneliness, he writes, is to pursue vitality, even in the smallest things. This means keeping alive your curiosity, your wonder, your spirit of adventure, love of learning, creative character, interest in people, your own eccentricities, and contemplative lifestyles. The author Janet Fitch writes, "Loneliness is the human condition. Loneliness is the human condition. Cultivate it the way it tunnels into you and allows your soul room to grow." I remember when I was in my teens, I had a tendency to pull away from the world and go off on my own, whether or not from my own shyness or from fear or rejection or who knows what, inadequacy. I enjoyed my solitude. I enjoyed my walks out in nature, but sometimes it did go too far. I remember almost viscerally the feeling of loneliness, standing at my bedroom window and looking out as if I could not connect. It was something of a bittersweet feeling, a desire for a sense of social belonging that I wasn't sure that I could have. The ideal of it was sweet. The lack of it was bitter. And I could and did get stuck in that feeling from time to time. At some point, I realized I needed to do something different about it, and I was inspired by a friend who always seemed engaged, whether or not they felt lonely or not. I was witnessing them from the outside and their engagement and their enjoyment of the world. And I made a conscious decision to try and be more like that person. It wasn't a significant interchange. It was more a change in behavior. But slowly, I began to feel a little bit better. It didn't change my personality. But when I saw the results, it changed the way I felt about myself. For those whose loneliness is deep and long-lasting, there does exist something of a catch-22. Cacioppo and Patrick describe it in real terms, in that this kind of loneliness settles into something more deep, depression, an inability to connect. This requires more than self-care. This requires the help of others, help of a therapist, some sort of counselor, a close friend who will not back away, to help draw us out. The more chronic, of course, this is, the less likely we are to ask for that kind of help. And so being around someone who you realize is withdrawing, it's important that you not let go, that you remain present, that you find whether you can help or find help that's needed. As Anne Morrow Lindberg says, "One is free like a hermit crab to change one's shell." For us humans, I think, not crab-like, sometimes we need a little help. And this is what true community can offer. This is what we can offer more here at the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Greater Naples, not just another social venue where the masks remain on literally and figuratively, and we keep each other's emotions at bay, but a place where we can be and find our true selves and provide a welcoming, listening, loving environment where others might find just enough comfort and safety to let go and find for themselves a deeper and more genuine connection. As we move from a situation of forced isolation into a time when we can reconnect, let's be gentle with each other, recognizing that we are still shedding the effects of our disconnection and that we are still vulnerable. For a congregation like this, this is where the rubber meets the road. In the smallest of our circumstances, when we interact across the pew or in front of the coffee pot or mask to mask in the hallway. We need to look into each other's eyes and connect. How important that is. Our mission to create that wider community includes just that kind of small action, looking into someone else's eyes. It comes when a new person has joined our circle, and we decide that the most important thing is to welcome them and make them comfortable. And it all comes when we respect each other to listen deeply enough to hear all the messages, spoken and unspoken, that are there being conveyed. We create purpose and meaning together, not as an isolated and lonely beings. And the more people we can fully welcome into that creative mix, reveling in our differences, the closer we come to the ideal of community that we've established. As the 19th century preacher Henry Melville wrote, "We cannot live only for ourselves. 1,000 fibers connect us, and along these fibers, as sympathetic threads, our actions run as causes, and they come back to us as effects." There is loneliness in this room, still and always. But together, we can make it our purpose to create a space where such feelings are recognized and honored as being something natural, and where, to the best of our ability, we can help dissipate the worst of those feelings, a place where we can love and live well together. So may it be. Excuse me. Let's sit with that for a little bit as we enjoy some music from Sean and Abby. Let's also take time to show our gratitude for this community and all that it does. This morning's offering will be gratefully received. If you're watching online, the information you need is there on the screen. A check to UUCGN or visit our website. Thank you very much. Through the rain, though Thank you. So take a few minutes now to talk about all the things that are going on. I do want to express to you the level of sort of renewed energy that's present in the congregation. A number of different groups meeting and talking about what's happening, adult enrichment, stewardship, our Progressive Voices team. Things are beginning to bubble, and it feels real good. You're here, so you know that we're welcoming people back into the sanctuary at full capacity. At full capacity out there in the ether. And if you're not comfortable being in the sanctuary, then we're streaming onto the pavilion, so you're welcome there. And of course, you're welcome to watch on Sunday morning. And we are, for those out there especially, serving coffee now on Sunday morning. So come on down. This week, Wonderful Wednesday returns, sort of alternating with Forum. We have a great drumming circle this week with Isaac Fernandez. If you haven't experienced that, I urge you to sign up. It's a lot of fun. There will be an alternative activity in case there's too many, and we'll sort of alternate those two activities. Come for Vespers at 5:30, and then a meal at just after that, and then we'll enter into the fun. We've had a regular announcement in the newsletter and here on Sunday morning that we would encourage you, love for you to begin to engage with our youth in whatever way is possible. Please check our newsletter to see all the various ways, very simple or large, that you can contribute. So please think about that. Part of that would be coming and doing a pumpkin carving on this Friday night. Which will be fun. It's out of the pavilion. Bring your own pumpkin, and we're going to create some beautiful things that may be up here next Sunday morning, we hope. There's a couple more spots for our chalice circles, our small group gatherings that are starting in November. Our chalice circles are a form of small group ministry. Groups of eight or so people meet regularly, twice a month sometimes, to reflect and share deeply on some more interesting, both intellectual and spiritual issues. So I would urge you to think about that. I'm not sure if we have a sign-up today, but if not, then a live sign-up, but if not, then let Anna know you'd be interested. Choir meets on Thursdays. If you're feeling courageous, even if you're not, come on and join us. Is there anything else we need to know?
6:30, and we need sopranos.
I think I heard a few. All right, 6:30 on Thursday nights out in the pavilion. It'll be a lot of fun. Okay, our closing hymn this morning is number 344, A Promise Through the Ages Rings. It's in the gray hymnal, number 344. We're going to sing verses 1, 3, and 2. The words in the right order will be on the screen, so... Whether you arrived here this morning with heart full or heart empty, with spirits high or low, rested or tired, hopeful or despairing. Whether you came here out of habit, conviction, loneliness, or curiosity, you belong here. Know in your heart that all you've been through and all that you are is honored here. And now, go back out into the world in peace, knowing that you are loved. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return to no person evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all beings. Have a wonderful day.